course, we have seen the economic recovery really being led by Asia, especially China, as they come out of the pandemic first. How does this resurgence in global cases threaten the recovery in Asia, given that we have so many export-dependent economies?
I think for Asia, we need to, as what we are doing now, each country is still undertaking its restrictions. But, you know, on the good news side, there has been recovery in trade and investment. And container shipping, for instance, has actually recovered and is at higher rate compared to the same time last year. So I think there are signs of recovery in Asia. And to the extent that a lot of that is internal between countries in East Asia, which are recovering fast, which are on a recovery path earlier than the rest of the world because it hit these countries earlier, then there should still be positive sources of growth. But of course, it's still going to be much lower than before the pandemic because the rest of the world is still in recovery stage. And I think what's a little bit worrying is that advanced countries which had shown signs of recovery because of this recent second wave of breakouts again, we think that there's going to be a slowdown in the advanced economies, which will then again also have an impact also for Asia.
What will this do to the progress that had been made so far on reducing poverty?
Yes, this is one of our greatest concerns because for the first time since 1998, we are seeing the rise of poverty. So poverty had been declining for the last three decades, and now we have seen a rise. Our most recent estimates are showing that we can see anything from 88 to about 115 million more people who will enter into extreme poverty. That's $1.90 a day poverty line. But we are also seeing what we call the new face of the poor, which is, above $1.90, you have below $3.20, you have another 50 million. And then in the next cohort, you have another 50 million. We call this the new face of the poor. And they tend to be more urban, more women, and more youth. And this is really, I think, what is really our great concern. And we need to double up our efforts to address this rise in poverty and the reversal of development gains that has been achieved for the last three decades. And on top of that, we have the human capital losses, kids not going to school, and also the food shortages, which is affecting nutrition of the children as well as of the women and of the population. And also the health, obviously the health impact, not just COVID, but the fact that as you are addressing COVID, what tends to happen is that the other essential health services are also suffer, especially women's health services, children immunization. So that's why in terms of the policy responses of countries, we must really redouble our efforts to prevent this huge setback in development gains, as well as get us back on track for ensuring that we protect the most vulnerable in our population.
Of course, the pandemic-inspired recession has affected developed economies as well as developing economies, and typically when that happens, the first thing that gets cut in budgets in developed economies is foreign aid. So how do you persuade developed countries not to do that?
They haven't cut aid in the sense that, fortunately, we already have the capital increases that were done recently. So for the next one and a half years, we have $160 billion that we can roll out to the poorest countries. But after that, depending on how long this recession-driven pandemic and all those very dire issues on poverty, on human capital that needs attention, the needs are going to be, I think, larger than what we had anticipated. Because we do think that there is the sharp contraction this year, and then there's going to be very, very slow recovery for the next 2 years because We think that the vaccines will probably only come on stream middle of next year, and then it will take time for the vaccination to be completed in whether you're talking about advanced countries or developing countries. So it will take time. And meanwhile, you still have to do the balancing the health and the economy. And that's still going to be slowing down growth. So in that kind of situation, you are still going to have to do a lot of policies to ensure that your populations can be protected, mm-hmm. your businesses can still be continued. And to the extent that it's going to impact on the financial sector, on your fiscal situation. So I do think the needs are, we are estimating the needs are going to be larger than what anybody had anticipated.
Mm-hmm. To what degree do you think that the problems presented by the pandemic are being aggravated by other problems heaped on top of that? And I'm thinking of geopolitical tension with China, trade issues. We also have political unrest right now in Thailand and Malaysia. How much is that adding to the problem?
Yeah, we describe the situation as a multiple crisis. You've got countries in conflict, you've got countries with political turmoil. I mean, there are countries where, like Lebanon, for instance, where there's no government in the midst of a pandemic, as well as the disaster that they had. So it is very challenging. And you mentioned the trade issue. I think that's another issue that we need to deal with in the sense that part of the recovery should and we hope will be continued trade and investment, continued openness for trade and investment, and that the disruption of supply chains that have happened will resume slowly back to normal, and global value chains or regional value chains will come back. Because that, especially for East Asia, that is a very important source of growth. So we do hope that the trade tensions, there will be lots of homework for us all to deal with all these issues. But I think at the end of the day, it is about the leadership in each country, how they can deal with whatever is the COVID crisis plus whatever other crisis they're dealing with. They have to really focus on what are the best targeted program to help the people. So even in a country like Lebanon, where we know the government is there's no functioning government, they've had a disaster, they've had so many people affected. So let's just focus, our assistance is just focusing on let's help the people for now. And that's about all mm-hmm. we can do in the multiple crisis situation.
I just very quickly want to get your thoughts on energy security as well, because we have Japan pledging carbon neutrality by 2050, a similar pledge by China for 2060. These pledges are all very nice, but just quickly, are you seeing any action that makes you optimistic that they'll be followed through on?
Well, we hope so. We are very focused that the crisis actually is an opportunity for transition to a low-carbon future. And Asia plays a very important role because 40% of greenhouse gas emissions come from Asia. 60% of the coal power plants are in Asia. So commitments and action in Asia will make a difference. And I do think technology and the cost effectiveness of various technology in the renewable energy sector will provide this opportunity. And China obviously has done a lot in that area, and even India has done a lot in solar. And hopefully, for Japan, it's a big challenge because after the Fukushima disaster with the nuclear, they've had to go back to coal. Now, how can they make that transition out of coal, mm-hmm. Reduce coal and increase new energy? Our position in the bank is that we no longer fund coal-fired power plants, but we do. What we do is we try to look at mm-hmm. how countries can transition to renewable energy. And solar, wind, yep. Battery storage, and to the extent that you still have coal-fired power plants, how do you have the storage and sequestration facilities there? Yep. And I think technology and innovation will be the key. And the final thing I would say is that energy reforms and carbon pricing and carbon taxes will also have to play a role.